reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal, and I'll keep track.
Could you say to the officers?
Yes. This is an ATF form violation case that the government tried as a gun trafficking case. But Purry was prevented from impeaching the government's evidence as to the actual form violations. This resulted in a fundamentally unfair trial. We request a remand for a new trial with only relevant evidence that goes to proving and disproving the form violations that are actually charged. First, turning to the prejudicial propensity evidence the government was allowed to present. The jury heard evidence that Mr. Purry shipped firearms under a prejudicial pseudonym, which was a federal felony for each shipment, that also violated ATF regulations for shipping with a common carrier. It violated state law, and conduct for which the postal inspector wanted to indict Mr. Purry. That was entirely improper evidence to present in a form violation case about false claims, false statements made on a form to buy firearms.
Were any of these statements objected to? And if so, what did the district court do?
Yes, Your Honor. The government, or the defense, I apologize, moved in limine to exclude evidence of shipment, any of the shipping evidence, and selling firearms.
The testimony that you referred to that was given in court, like about, you know, postal inspectors want to indict and things like that. Were there objections to those?
Yes, Your Honor. Before the, most of the evidence came out during the final government witness, the case agent, when they played the clips of the interrogation. And before that was played, there was a sidebar, or I forget if it was a sidebar or outside of the presence of the jury, before that witness came on. And the defense reasserted that none of the shipment evidence should come in. And the court reaffirmed its consistency.
That's none of this, but I thought there's a difference between none of it should have come in and the specific chunks that were played, because some of them seem to me to be fairly questionable and others perhaps not. So were there specific objections to the specific pieces that were played?
There were objections to, it appears that the defense had some indication of the clips that will be played. That was the motion to examine the video that was filed before the trial began. And so that was most of the clips. But then the government stated that when the defense asked, can you tell us which clips you're going to play? The government said at page 587 of the record, you're just going to see that as it goes. So there wasn't, the defense did the best they could to object. It was a four-hour interrogation, and the government chose certain portions, minutes, a couple minutes here, a couple minutes there, to play. And so the defense did the best they could to object and did preserve this issue by consistently saying that nothing about the shipment evidence should come in, and the evidence should focus on whether on the elements of the false statements on an ATF form charges that were at issue.
So let me get back to the statements that actually came in. Are you saying they might have come in, you know, sort of, what was the government's answer when it came in? Did they say, well, we didn't mean to play that, just right next to the bar to play or what?
Well, right after the clip was played where the ATF agent, special agent, stated that the shipping conduct was a federal felony, there was a sidebar, objection sidebar, and the defense talked about how this was what the minefield, quote-unquote, that the government said it was trying to avoid by carefully selecting clips. And the government said that, sort of brushed it off on page 66 of the record, that, okay, well, he's shipping records and it's a felony, but people know that's a felony. It's not any more prejudicial than the shipping evidence itself, but it is, because the jury, just like most juries, didn't know if these form offenses were even felonies, let alone whether any other conduct would be a felony, as he was just doing.
You make some kind of motion at that sidebar, like, you know,
yes,
to strike it and to give a limiting instruction.
There was a motion for a mistrial, which was denied, and that's at 66 through 69. That's most of the argument. And then that was denied, and the court did read a limiting instruction, the model instruction 3.10 at that point. But after that is when there was another clip played where the agent says, this also violates state law. And this is, and so this, the prejudice continued beyond that. And at every point after the clips were played, if it was prejudicial, the government requested a sidebar, reasserted its mistrial, its objection and its mistrial request. And that, the government, the district court erred by not granting that mistrial request because this evidence was not probative. And the reason it's not 404B evidence and the reason it does not survive a 403 balancing test or should not have is because these guns that were intercepted by the postal inspector were not the guns charged in the indictment. They're guns of a different origin. They're not any of the 14 guns. And the government admitted that.
But the point of the evidence was that he was, it was a mode of evidence, right? Why is he doing this? Because he had the proof of knowledge, at least, and intent, or knowledge. Right?
Knowledge of the false, the claim was false.
And so the fact that he was using, that he had a reason to be doing it, which is that these guns, he was sending the guns to California because he couldn't have bought them in California, seems pertinent, no?
It's not, Your Honor, because they're not, this might be a different case if the guns that were shipped, that shipping evidence was tied to the actual guns he bought in the four transactions at issue in the indictment. But the government conceded that it couldn't prove that. They weren't the guns. But the jury was left with the impression that it was these guns, that this was a consistent, that he bought these guns and then shipped them off. And that's not actually what happened. The government didn't have that proof. And that's what really distinguishes this from a sort of, either it's definitely not inextricably intertwined for that reason, but it also doesn't show motive as to these forms, why he would put a false statement on these forms to obtain guns, you know, to get around California state laws, because those weren't the guns that were shipped. And that's really the distinguishing factor.
Why is it relevant that he was engaged in shipping guns, whether it was these or not, and that's why he bought these guns and bought them
because they aren't the guns charged in the indictment. And he wasn't charged with a gun trafficking case.
Why is it relevant that this is the conduct that he's engaged in? And therefore, that's why he did it in this particular case.
Because it's just propensity evidence at that time. It's not tied to the charged offense, so it can't show a motive for the charged offense. Whether he bought guns from a different location, a different place, and shipped them doesn't bear on what he did with these guns in the indictment, his knowledge at the moment he wrote the form, the answers to the form.
What about, the prejudice from anything that happened in this trial, given the fact that, the forms definitely had a false address, which he admitted.
A P.O. box.
There was plenty of evidence that he actually lives in Oakland. So what else matters?
So the reason that these prejudicial propensity evidence, that this admission was not harmless, turns on the second issue I raised, is that the restriction of impeachment of the government's evidence as to materiality, that fourth prong of the fourth element of the form offense, is that the statement must have been material to the sale. The government's theory of proof on that fourth element turned on the big gun witnesses. At 406 and 407 of the record shows it the best. The government stated during trial that we have to prove materiality. I have to be able to ask.
The standard isn't whether these particular people would have actually sold them the guns. It's whether they could legally have sold them the guns, right?
That's not what the government's theory was. The government's theory at trial actually relied on what these employees would or would not have done. The owner testified in three employees. And that's when the government responded to the Rule 29 motion, the government stated that at 101 to 102 stated, all these employees testified that if they knew it was a P.O. box and they knew he was not a Nevada resident, they would not have sold the guns. It's material. The statements are material.
On that subject, you received the, I'll call it the Brady material, pertaining to the paperwork that big guns before trial or something like that?
Yes, I believe it was the Saturday before the Monday trial.
All right, now, what is your theory of what you would or could have done with that information if you had received it earlier, and how much earlier?
Well, 2 points on that, Your Honor. First, the district court should have allowed that violation's evidence of forbidden guns practices to be used as impeachment material in this trial. So that should have been able to occur.
Impeachment, you mean of the Big Gun witnesses who testified?
Yes, Your Honor, of the owner and the three witnesses. And at the very least, the owner who testified as to when they would or would not be allowed to sell guns.
He didn't allow it to be used.
It was not allowed. It was shut down at page 49 to 51 of the record when the defense started to question about mistakes on forms. And
well, that's not a Brady problem. That's a different problem.
It is, Your Honor, and it arose from this late violations evidence, late disclosure, and the disclosure
well, originally. Why did it arise from a late disclosure? You had the material, and if you should have allowed it, I can't see why you shouldn't have allowed it, but
right.
I don't know. You separately raised that question, did you?
It was raised with the Brady issue, and perhaps I do realize that when I was preparing,
well,
I should have had a separate subhead,
well,
but it's raised in the Brady issue.
As I understand, your Brady claim is that we received the materials too late to do us any good, but as Judge Berzon just indicated, you were able to use it to impeach the Big Gun witnesses. I mean, you had time to do that, it's just that the judge ruled against you. So that has nothing to do with the lateness of receiving the greater material, right?
It doesn't, at least it's the Big Gun owner. But we,
right.
Right.
Or anybody.
And that was...
Let me go back to my question. So what was the prejudice? In other words, what could you have done or would you have done if you'd received this greater material, what, a week earlier, we'll say?
Well, as... Specifically for the impeachment evidence, the defense could have explored whether the other three employees who testified were involved in any of those transactions Big Gun received a letter on. That was evidence we did not know.
What
is
by involved in it? You mean, isn't there an employee's name on the form?
The ATF form violation evidence that the defense received and that was filed in the record does not say what employees were involved in what transactions. It's not the actual forms, it's an ATF.
No. You get these individual forms like the one your client was convicted of making a misstatement on. And that each form is signed by the seller, right? With an ATF licensee or an agent of licensee, right?
That's not what the evidence was. That's not what the form violation, the Big Gun form violation evidence, it wasn't that. It was an ATF printout from ATF. It wasn't the individual forms of those other violations that Big Gun received a letter for. And it didn't say what employee was involved.
Is that the reason the judge didn't allow? What was the reason the judge gave for not allowing you to do this?
The judge said that it was a sideshow. That it was.
That is what?
A sideshow. Essentially, under 403, it's confusing. It's not material. It's not relevant to the form defenses.
Okay.
And that's at.
Why would it have. How would it, I understand that sounds like a problem.
Right.
But if you'd gotten it earlier, you still would have ruled the same thing.
Right, Your Honor, and so I think there are two problems with the Brady evidence, and I do wish I would have put a separate heading for this second issue. It is the most concrete problem with the Brady evidence in the case, and it's an impeachment issue, really, at its core, just a constitutional right to impeach the government's witness.
But it kind of eliminates the Brady problem, because it says he wouldn't have allowed it in, no matter when you got it, so what's the difference?
Because that was erroneous, because the government's theory on materiality...
It may be erroneous, but it's not a Brady problem.
Is an impeachment problem. It was a restriction, and it was improper for the government to not find that was impeachment material and to deny it wholeheartedly.
Anything else you could have raised or argued if you had that Brady material earlier besides, you know, let's say, more impeachment of more people? Anything else?
To explore if these employees have misinformed people on how to fill out the forms. The misinformed, there were so many violations that we should have been able to explore how those violations in those other cases at the exact time when Mr. Purry was buying guns, how those came about. Were these employees not trained properly? Were they misinforming how...
How was that... What issue at trial does that tend to prove or disprove? You know, how bad the Big Guns bookie
It would go to whether it's a material misstatement, whether it was knowingly false, because if the employee said you could put a P.O. box.
Well, okay. What's your definition of material on the form that your client is convicted of making a material misstatement? What's your definition of material?
The jury was instructed that a false statement is material if it had a natural tendency to influence or was capable of influencing big gun enterprises into believing the firearms could be lawfully sold to the defendant. That was what the jury was instructed, and that's the model instruction.
Do you agree with that instruction? I mean, you're not challenging.
There's no objection to that.
All right, so you're saying if you could have shown that big gun employees, you know, didn't pay any attention to the information on the form that they just want to sell guns, that no matter what a buyer put on the form, it would not have made any difference to big guns, so therefore it was not material.
And that's exactly what we should have been able to explore in an alternative defense, but especially and directly impeach in this trial the way the evidence went down. Because the government relied on that testimony from those big gun employees in closing at 684 to 687 to say, we've proven materiality. All these employees testified they would never sold those guns if they knew it was a post office and not a Nevada resident. I apologize, Your Honor. Thank you so much.
Good morning. May it please the court. Adam Flake for the United States. With respect to the first issue, and that is the specificity of the objection to the 404B evidence, I just want to be really clear about what I am arguing, which is I'm not saying that they didn't object to the shipping evidence. They did object to the shipping evidence
in general.
What they did not do was object to the specific portion of the video where the agent said the shipping evidence is incredible.
It was on the tape,
Your Honor, and I simply disagree with the defense about whether or not they had an opportunity to. We, throughout the trial, we said, okay, we are about to play portion, you know, I'm making this up, but, you know, we're about to play from video 101, you know, minute 101 to 103, and there were points where they did object to that before we played the video. You can find one of those at ER 72, and you can find it.
You said this in time that they could have gone listen to it and known whether to object to it.
Your Honor, they were aware of what was on the video. They did file that document.
But they weren't necessarily aware of what was on, you know, number such and such.
Well, Your Honor, I can't necessarily speak to what they were aware of, but I can say that at some points we did say, we are about to play this portion of the video, and they said, we object because they're about to do hearsay. And so that there were points there's one of those at ER 72, and there's another one, they raised standing objections to the next two clips that we're about to play at ER 87. So this notion that they just had no idea what was coming, I don't think is inaccurate.
To me, this is another one of a not unusual set of cases in which the prosecutor goes out on a limb that he doesn't need to go out on because the evidence is perfectly clear. What is the justification and what was the need for playing a tape that specifically referred to the things they were doing as crimes that were not charged? Why isn't that a prejudicial problem, and what was the point of it?
Your Honor, as the appellate attorney defending this case, that's the answer we always get,
and it's really maddening.
Your Honor, the evidence was relevant. It was thoroughly litigated. It was relevant to proving our case.
I understand what the shipping evidence in general was relevant, but why it was specifically relevant in any way and not a 404B violation whether or some, maybe not a 404B violation, but at least a 403 problem, that what they were doing was specifically suspected to be independent crimes, and that the Postal Service wanted to prosecute them and so on. I can't imagine.
Your Honor, I think that's the point of that. That's why I started out saying about this specific objection, which is if they had raised this specific objection and said, fine, we thoroughly litigated the shipping evidence, we understand that it's coming in, but please keep this separately out, this mention by the postal inspector. At that point, we may well have said, we agree, the court may, or we may have said we disagree, and the court may have said, I agree with the defense that I'm keeping this specific evidence out because it is too prejudicial. But they did not do that. They objected to the shipping evidence generally. And then once we had put in this evidence, then they said, and on appeal they say, well, this, the fact that it was a crime is somehow categorically different than the shipping evidence generally. Therefore, we move for a mistrial. Well, they moved for a mistrial. The district court gave a limiting instruction out of an abundance of caution, even though I didn't find that it was erroneous to put it in. The district court did give a limiting instruction, and that was just how it came in. If it had been litigated differently, the evidence possibly wouldn't have come in, but the district court held that the shipping evidence was relevant, and we put the shipping evidence in.
What was the limiting instruction?
The limiting instruction said something along, I can find it. It just said something along the lines of he's only on trial for the crimes that are charged in the indictment, and you know, the fact that his crimes, you know, his actions might have constituted a separate crime or not is not relevant. Something along those lines.
You're not contending that the statement that the postal inspectors want to indict him for a federal postal offense is relevant, are you?
I don't think that the fact that they wanted to indict him necessarily is especially relevant in any way, but it was part of the shipping evidence. It was the two interrogators talking to Purry about the fact that he was doing shipping, and we were allowed to put that evidence in.
It's part of the shipping evidence that can come in even though it's irrelevant and prejudicial.
I'm not saying that it's irrelevant. I'm saying
it's irrelevant to.
But Your Honor, I'm not. It was part of the shipping evidence. The postal inspector.
But what's the relevant to that? The postal inspectors want to indict him.
Your Honor, that particular part, it was part of the tape where he was talking about
it. But my question is, why is it relevant?
It's not especially relevant, other than the fact that it's shipping.
Generally relevant, and it's prejudicial, isn't it?
Your Honor, it's prejudicial. The fact that it was a crime, I concede, it doesn't have any relevance other than the shipping evidence generally had relevance. And again, if there had been an objection to it.
If the fact that it was a crime in California to have these guns might have been relevant. But the question of whether the shipping was a crime is really not relevant.
I agree, Your Honor. And once again, if there had been a specific objection on that basis that, hey, the shipping evidence is okay, let that, you know, the court has ruled it's okay, the fact that it's a crime is not okay, keep that part of it out. The court could have ruled on it. They didn't make that objection. After it came in, they got a limiting instruction.
I don't know how they managed to object to what they did object to, but it does seem very difficult. If somebody, you have a lengthy tape, and you say, I'm going to play numbers, you know, but it's so-and-so to so-and-so, and they're supposed to know in their head what's in there. That just seems impossible. It was a comment that you'll know when you hear it actually made.
Your Honor, I mean, it's in the record. I can read it to the court. But
then what were they supposed to do?
Your Honor, they did know ahead of time what clips we were going to play. They litigated over it. They filed.
They know what specific clips you were going to play. I thought you said you didn't. They only know when you sort of stood up and said, I'm going to play these and this now.
Your Honor, they had a list of several of the clips that they had a list of the clips that they were going to play, and they filed a motion in limine about them before trial. And I don't want to get myself into trouble. I don't want to speak for what the defense had in front of them and how they had their their information organized.
You said, and I thought she said, that until you stood up and said, I'm going to play these particular minutes, they didn't know you were going to play those particular minutes.
Again, Your Honor, I don't want to get myself in trouble and speak for what they had in their mind. But
were they told?
Yes, Your Honor.
They were told that you were going to play these minutes.
I don't think that they weren't told right the minute of trial, but we gave them a list of the portions of the video that we were going to play, and they objected. They raised specific objections to some of the portions of the video that we were going to play. That's at ER 176 through 179. I don't think that we were surprising them by the portions of the video that I don't think the record supports that. But again,
there's a difference, obviously, and I thought you said something different originally, and I thought she said something different originally.
I apologize for any confusion, Your Honor. And I hate to overmake this point, but if the defense felt like we were surprising them, if they felt like they didn't have adequate opportunity, the government does not get to dictate to the defense what they can object to and what they cannot object to. And if they had wanted more time and if they had wanted to look at each clip, they certainly could have asked the court to do so. And it would have been, you know, the government doesn't get to decide things like that.
I want to ask you a question on the materiality. In response to one of my questions, the defense counsel read that jury instruction on materiality, and it seems to support their position that evidence that the employees had begun habitually disregarded information or entries or even blanks or, you know, false entries on these forms is relevant to prove lack of materiality, because whatever's on the, I guess, the jury is whatever's on the form doesn't make any difference to the licensee. Is that the materiality definition?
No, Your Honor. The materiality is, and I can find the jury instruction, but it's whether it has a natural tendency to influence
the licensee. The ATF licensee.
Yes. As to whether or not the sale is lawful. And so if somebody is making...
But the point of the evidence is if the licensee continually disregards information on the forms, it's not material because they never pay attention to it.
That's their argument, Your Honor, but I disagree with it, because whether or not the ATF, the FFL disregards it doesn't have any bearing on whether or not the sale is lawful.
But that's what the instruction says.
No, Your Honor. If I could just read it. So this is at ER 663 in the jury instruction. False statement is...
662?
663.
Okay, go ahead.
The false statement was material, that is, the false statement had a natural tendency to influence or was capable of influencing Big Gun into believing that the firearm could be lawfully sold to the defendant. And I think that's a very different question than whether the non-careful or deceitful, or whatever you want to describe the particular FFL, whether they would have done it is a different question than whether Mr. Curry misled them into believing that they could lawfully do it.
Well, that's the point. It's not misleading because they never pay attention to it.
It's misleading.
It doesn't have the capability of influencing the ATF licensee.
It has a natural...
I mean, that's the theory of their case, isn't it?
I guess so, Your Honor. But I think that it's incorrect, because I think that the question is whether this would naturally influence an FFL to believe that they could lawfully do it.
That's one branch of the instruction. The other branch is, we're capable of, and with this license, it's not capable of doing it. I mean, that's the theory.
But it's capable of influencing them into believing that the firearm could lawfully be sold.
Right.
That's
right. I mean, the whole point, I think, of the defense is, you know, materiality, say defense and this impeachment evidence is that it's not capable of influencing this licensee because they never paid attention.
the question is whether it could influence them into believing that they could do it lawfully. And
whatever was on there could influence them to do it lawfully.
Excuse me?
I said whatever was on the form could influence his licensee to do it lawfully.
Your Honor, I think the question is whether the representations that he made could lead them into thinking it was lawful, and regardless of whether, you know, the person was asleep at the switch or whether the person was, not doing their job in any way.
Is the Supreme Court Abramski case relevant to this? I thought that it essentially adopted something like the position you're taking. That is, that the question was what was lawfully the case rather than what was specifically the case in the instance under the facts of the case.
That's correct, Your Honor.
And I understand that to be what you're saying.
Yes. Okay. And I'll conclude if the court has any questions. Thank you.
Yes, Your Honor. I looked back. The motion to examine the court video does state that the government gave an hour and 20 minutes of clips that it intended to play, and so the defense did make objections, and the defense did object to 1519 to 1530, which contained the shipping evidence, the felony evidence, sorry, that the shipping was a felony. It's not stated in that motion. So it's not in the motion that basis, but when right before the government admitted that evidence, the government did say at 587, you're just going to see that as it goes, when the defense said, can you give us the clips again? Because it had been whittled down, the government, the district court had excluded some of the evidence.
They told you a big chunk of things that
yes.
You objected to the whole chunk.
Right, to the most prejudicial things, yes. And
but you didn't object on specific rights to specific sub-pieces because you didn't know what they were.
We didn't know those clips because they had been changed after the limine rulings and the rulings during trial. But the government also said...
They were narrowed, but they weren't.
Yes, they were narrowed, yes, somewhat. But the government did say right after that, I can tell you there's no discussion of selling firearms, which was true. There's no discussion of any additional criminal conduct, and that's not true because the jury didn't know that shipping was a felony until the agent said it. Shipping itself would not necessarily be a crime. So the government misled, I believe, the district court and the defense into believing that there would be no discussion of criminal conduct, just of shipping conduct. And I would like to briefly touch on the materiality issue. The government's theory was that in closing at 687, had each of them, the Big Gun employees, each of them known that the address was a P.O. box or a mailbox, that sale could not and would not have gone through. And if each one of those individuals had known the defendant did not reside in Nevada, that sale could not and would not have gone through. So the government chose to make its materiality argument turn on the Big Gun employees, not on Abramski.
Can you tell me where in your brief the argument is with regard to the judge's exclusion of the impeachment as opposed to the grand jury?
Yes, Your Honor. It is referenced in the opening brief at the end of the Brady section. I apologize if I didn't have that clear. At page 16, the defendant says, the district court compounded the constitutional error by refusing to allow Purry to question Allen about the violations at 16 or present any violations evidence to the jury. And then in the reply brief, we reasserted, at the very least, Purry should have been able to, at page 11, at the very least, the district court should have permitted Purry to query the Big Gun employees about these violations. At the very least, that should have occurred. So I apologize for not putting that in a separate heading and raising it as an issue in that respect, but we did argue that, and it is an important trial error that, compared with the shipping and the felony evidence of a trial, requires remand for a new trial with less prejudicial evidence. Thank you, Your Honor.